welcome in this session on legal perspectives in conservation of nature. This topic is one of the important topics of science teaching learning at secondary level. Because the learners already know what nature is, what are the issues related to the nature and conservation of nature, and what can be done by the social agencies, by the government agencies to protect our nature. But it is equally important to know that what are the legal perspectives, including the constitutional provisions, the laws, the international declarations related to the conservation of nature, so that a broad understanding of these concepts can be developed among the learners. I am Dr. Gaurav Singh, your course instructor for the course Pedagogy of Science. And today I am going to discuss basically about certain basic rules, regulations, provisions and declarations related to the conservation of nature with legal perspective. Whenever we think about the legal perspective in India, we derive our goals, we derive our duties, we derive our responsibilities from our constitution. So when you talk about the conservation of the nature with your students, first you need to tell to your students that what are the constitutional provisions for conservation of the nature in India. And if you see the constitution, there are three important articles, though there are many other articles too, but there are three very important articles: Article 21, Article 48A and Article 51AG. Article 21 basically ensures that every individual may be safe from any activity which injures his life, health or physique. When it is saying every individual, it is not saying every human being. Every individual includes every living being. That much explanation has been adopted by different, in different cases. If you read the case studies, legal case studies, if you read the decisions given by the honorable courts, high courts and supreme courts in India, you will see that this Article 21 has been applied at many places. Then Article 48A basically talks about the protection and improvement of the environment and safeguarding the forest and wildlife. Again, it is an important constitution. Then when we talk about our fundamental duties in Article 51A, there are 11 fundamental duties. The students already know what are the fundamental duties, but one of the most important fundamental duties out of the 11 is 51AG, where it has been written that it shall be duty of every citizen of the India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. You don't find such strong recommendations, duties about the nature, about the conservation of the nature, about the protection of the environment, about the improvement and safeguarding the forest and wildlife in any constitution of the world. It is not that after constitution only we have started about thinking the legal framework or the legal perspective of conservation of the nature. Even before then, that during the British period also, there were many legislative measures before independence which were basically being used to protect the nature. They have protected or not, whether the nature was consumed without any limitation, that can be an issue of the discussion. You can ask your students to search such case studies of pre-independent area where such laws have been implemented. There are acts like the Oriental Gas Company Act 1857, there is North Canal and Drainage Act 1873, then there is Indian Fisheries Act 1897, the Explosive Act 1908, the Poison Act 1919, the Indian Forest Act 1927 and the Motor Vehicle Act 1938. But when India got independence and we put these things in our constitution, be framed in many new acts, be modified many older British acts also. So we get the acts like the River Board Act 1956, the Atomic Energy Act 1962, the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, which was amended in 1988. Let us talk about some very common acts. The Environmental Protection Act 1986. This act basically defines environment as environment includes water, air, and the land and the interrelationship which exists among and between water, air, and land and the human beings, the other living creatures, plants, microorganisms, and property. So the relation between the two and relation within that race, within that group, both are covered here. Besides the physical and biological aspect, the environment embraces the social, economical, cultural, religious, and several other aspects as well. The environment thus, important line is this, the environment thus is an amalgamation of various factors surrounding an organism that interact not only with the organism but also among themselves. It means that the aggregation of all the external conditions and influences which are affecting life and development of organs of human being, animals, plants, everything is being covered. Then there are acts like the Forest Conservation Act 1980, the Air Prevention and Control Pollution Act 1981, which was further amended in 1987, the Environmental Protection Act I have already talked in 1986, Motor Vehicle Act 1988, National Environment Tribunal Act 1992, National Environment Tribunal Act further in 1995, the National Environment Appellant Authority Act 1997. Before talking about some important acts of India, let us also think that what are the international scenario. Environment has been an area of concern not only in India but almost all part of the world. So there are many declarations, many meetings, many summits. Every 2 years a summit takes place, which is always in the news, in the media. So you can use such type of pictures, stories, video clips of different declarations, different summits to introduce the concept and to develop the interest of your students in such topics, so that when next time any declaration or any summit is taking place, they focus on it. One very famous, or you can say the one of the fundamental declarations in terms of environment, was the Stockholm Declarations in Sweden in 1972. And it accepts that man has started using environment injudiciously to keep pace with the scientific and technological advancement. Important point is that we have started using environment injudiciously to keep pace with the science and technological advancement. So, to improve and sustain the human environment has become an important topic all over the world. Man has tried to use natural resources brutally. This has led to the imbalance in nature, health problems, decrease in non-renewable sources. People of developing countries are living below the expected level. Therefore, we must give priority to the environmental improvement. And thus, Stockholm declarations declare that the increasing population has given rise to many problems regarding environmental conservation. Therefore, man must try to improve his environment with social, scientific, and industrial growth. The time has come when we must bring positive environmental changes at the world level. Each citizen, community, and organization have to come together and accept the responsibility to work for reaching environmental goals. Then there is a very famous summit called Rio Earth Summit 1992. I am not going to talk about detail in this summit here. You need to give an activity to your students that let them explore what Rio Earth Summit was, what were its objectives, what were its outcomes, what was its declaration, the countries who have signed it, whether they followed that or not, who are the countries who get out of this declaration or the treaty which was signed at the Rio Earth Summit 1992. All these stories are in media. Let them explore, let them try to understand. But the important thing is that Rio Earth Summit identifies the area where we need to work immediately to protect the nature. Areas were decrease in forest area, increasing greenhouse effect, depletion of ozone layer, use of new technologies for air conditioning, increasing human population, decrease in fossil fuels, control of pollution, biodiversity, and many more. And many international agencies are working basically to realize the goals, to concretize the goals which have been set or being set in different summits and declarations. One such organization is FAO, you all know, Food and Agriculture Organization, which was founded in 1945 in order to resolve the food related problems in many underdeveloped countries. Then World Health Organization, a very famous one, WHO, in 1946 it was established, which takes responsibility for the health related work all over the world. It helps the countries in family planning, polio, tuberculosis, etc. Then there is an organization called IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Natural Resources, which was established in 1948, and its role is basically to ensure to prevent the misuse of nature and its resources. Then there is WWF, World Wildlife Fund, 1961 was the year when it was established. Its main work is to preserve the wild fauna. So many projects, like in India, the project Tiger was funded by WWF for long. Then there is an organization called Convention on International Trades of Endangered Species in Wild Fauna and Flora, 1972, which basically helps in protecting the endangered species. And there is an organization called United Nations Environmental Program, UNEP, 1972, which basically guides various projects on environment and related fields. Then there is IEEP, International Environmental Protection Program, which was started in 1975, which undertakes the responsibility of educating and sponsoring seminars and conferences on environments. And there is again an agency under the guidance of UNEP called EarthScan, which was founded in 1976, and they are also working for the improvement of the nature. If you talk about the Environmental Protection Act 1986, you can say it is an umbrella legislation which is designated as a framework for the coordination of the central and state authorities which are established under Water Prevention and Control Act 74 and Air Prevention and Control Act 1981. Under this Environmental Protection Act 1986, EPA, the central government is empowered to take measures necessary to protect and improve the quality of the environment by setting standards of the emission and discharge, by regulating the location of the industries, by managing the hazardous waste, by protecting the public health and welfare. From time to time, central government issues notification under this act basically for protecting the ecological and sensitive areas, as well as issue guidelines on the matters under it. These rules basically lay out down the procedures for setting standards on the emission and discharging the environmental pollutants. You all have seen Bharat 2, Bharat 4, Bharat 6 are the standard, BS4, BS6, all these standards have been announced by this under this act. The rules which were basically notified in 1986 to enact the Environmental Protection Act, they prescribe the parameters to the central government under which it can issue orders on provision and restriction of the location and operation of the industries in different areas. The rules lay down the procedures of taking samples and serving notice and submitting samples for analysis and laboratory reports, and the functions of the laboratory are also described under the rules. Then for water, there is some specific, though there is Environmental Protection Act, but there are some specific act for particular areas. Like for water, what should be the quality standard for drinking water in India? There is an agency called Indian Council for Medical Research, ICMR, which sets the quality standards and which are as per the UN guidelines. Similarly, there are Indian standards which basically regulates the discharge of industrial effluents. Then there is an act called Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974. It basically prohibits the discharge of the pollutants in water bodies beyond a given standard and lay down the penalties for non-compliance. Then there is another one act, Water Prevention and Control Pollution Cess Act 1977. This act basically provides for a levy and collection of a cess on water consumed by the industries and local authority. So the water cess rules were formulated in 1978, and they were defining the standards and indicators, what kind of water can be supplied, how much bill can be charged from you, what should be the location of the meter at the every consumer's home, and everything has been discussed in these acts. Then for air, there is an act called Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981. This act basically provides means for control and abatement of the air pollution. This act seeks to combat air pollution by prohibiting the use of polluting fuels and substances, as well as by regulating appliances that gives rise to air pollution. Under this act, if any industrial plant is being established or operating in a pollution controlled area, it requires consent from the state boards. The boards are also expected to test the air in the air pollution control area, inspect the pollution control equipment and manufacturing process, everything. Then there are National Ambient Air Quality Standards, called NAAQS. These are basically notified by Central Pollution Control Board in April 1994, and these are for all the pollutants. These are deemed to be the labels of the air quality necessary with an adequate margin of the safety to protect public health, vegetation and property. So NAAQS basically prescribe specific standards for industry, for residential area, for rural and other sensitive areas. Industry specific emission standards for iron plants, for steel plants, for cement plants, for fertilizer plants, for oil refineries, for aluminum industry and all that. Then one more act was basically introduced to control the radioactive waste was the Atomic Energy Act in 1982. In 1988, the Motor Vehicle Act was enacted to regulate the vehicular traffic, besides ensuring proper packaging, labeling and transportation of the hazardous waste. Many aspects of the vehicular pollution have been notified under EPA also in 1986. Mass emission standards were notified in 1990, which were made more strengthened in 1996. In 2000, these standards were revised again, and for the first time, separate obligations for vehicle owners, manufacturers and enforcing agencies were stipulated. Then Motor Vehicle Amendment Act recently in 2019 has been implemented throughout the country since September 1, 2019, and now the penalty has been increased up to 10 times on various violations, including the pollution one. Then there is Act for Forest and Wildlife, like the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which was amended in 1991. If you read the act, you will find that this act provides the protection of the listed species of flora and fauna and establishes a network of ecologically important protected areas. It empowers the state and central governments to declare any area as wildlife sanctuary, national park or the closed area, and it also regulates the hunting of the wildlife, protection of specific plants and sanctuaries, national parks, closed areas, restricted trades and commerce of wild animals and animal articles, and other miscellaneous matters related to it. Then there is an act called Forest Conservation Act 1980, which restricts the powers of the states in respect to the de-reservation of the forest, use of forest land for non-forest purpose, that is called non-forest purpose, including clearing any forest land for the cultivation of the cash crops, plantation crops, horticulture or any other purpose other than the reforestation. Then there are acts basically to control the hazardous wastes. There is Biomedical Waste Management and Handling Rule 1998. These were formulated basically along with the parallel lines to proper the disposal, segregation and transport of the infectious wastes. Then there is a rule called Municipal Waste Management and Handling Rules 2000, whose aim was to enable municipalities to dispose of the municipal solid waste into a scientific manner. Then there are amendment rules called Hazardous Waste Management and Handling Amendment Rules 2000, which basically a recent notification, and it is of the view to provide guidelines for the import and export of hazardous waste in the country. So if you see the legal framework of the pollution control or the protection of the wildlife or protection of the environment, it is quite comprehensive. There are laws, there are acts, there are rules for almost every area which is causing pollution nowadays. But the only thing is, neither our students are aware about these rules nor the society. What we can do? What should be the best way to teach such topic? There can be two things which I can suggest. One thing is case studies. If there are some cases against a factory, against a group, against a community, if some restrictions have been imposed under any act, those stories should be shared with the students, or students should be given the opportunities to explore about those situations, those incidents, and collect the information, which rule was implemented, why it was implemented, which act was applicable in such situation, what happened, what was the rule, what was the case, how it was tackled, how the decision was taken. All these things can be given at the case studies to the students, and that will be the best way. Second thing, you can organize some community awareness campaign also in this area, that if the community nearby the school, there are some, you know, violations of Wildlife Protection Act or Environmental Protection Act. So awareness campaign can be organized by your students on different legal perspectives of rules and acts related to environmental protection. So when they will discuss with the community members, when they will tell them that no, you should not do it, there is this rule against it, there is this rule against it, it will increase the awareness level of your learners about these topics. So I hope that this session will help you in understanding different legal perspectives for the environmental protection, and you will train your students to deal with such situation and to make the society and themselves aware. Let us all pledge to protect our world, our environment. Thank you very much.